Okay. Getting somewhere here. I've been in contemplation here for a while, struggling with some essential teaching to connect the pieces. And just connected them. So, I have to give you a little background. What is the puzzle I solve? Let's start there. Well, you know, in Christianity, one of the essential tenets of Christianity is that Jesus paid our debts. Okay? Paid the debts of sin for us, freed us from our debts. The payment we needed to make for our sin, Jesus freed us from that. Somehow Jesus' death freed us from our spiritual debt. This is essential to Christianity. Now, this has always puzzled me, but so I was determined. I think I may be able to explain this to you in very clear, pure clarity terms. So, if you're willing, we can look at this, and let's see if I can fill in the blanks here. So, let's start out with Zoroastrianism, the original Zoroaster, ancient Persia, which is now Iran. One of the world's oldest religions, for sure. Maybe almost, I don't know, was it 1500 years before the Common Era, before Christ, or maybe even more. And its teaching, along with, I believe, Manichaean teaching, which sort of seemed to be a continuation of Zoroastrian teaching by Manichaeanism, which has lasted into the Middle Ages, actually. It was the central heresy that Christianity denounced. What these teachings, these are ancient religious teachings that were very popular, especially teaching of Manu, was also from Persia, was that there's a battle between good and evil, between God and this force that's anti-God, and that God put humans on this planet to do work, to decide this struggle, to help God overcome evil, and to somehow redeem, like in Manichaeism is to redeem the light from the darkness here by working on this planet and being here. In other words, our work here is a redemptive work. We're supposed to redeem light from darkness, okay? This is the essence of their teachings, really. So we have like some super important role that God created us to do, this role here. Now, okay. So the debt would be the darkness that we're paying off through our work here, somehow a redemptive work. And this is the belief. Now, Jesus came in and did something that just changed everybody's idea of this. He said that he freed us from our debt, indebted, meaning that God gave us this human body, and that we have to pay off this gift, this debt of a human body in a world, by working for God to redeem this world from darkness. So we have this massive spiritual debt to pay off to God. These are the ancient teachings, in essence, if you really look at them. Now, what Jesus did is he came into this world. And by not opposing evil, by not opposing his crucifixion, by not opposing this, he said, hey, your ideas are mistaken. And he said, God, there is no battle between... There's that a bug there. There is no battle between good and evil, God and evil and light and darkness. I'm not here to redeem the world that way. I'm here to set you free from this ideology, this ancient ideology, which had been prevalent for almost 2,000 years. And so, what Jesus did is he showed God is not interested in this world at all, in the world of nature at all. Jesus didn't do anything to improve this world, to improve the world of nature at all. In fact, so what Jesus really did was told us we don't have any redemptive role in relation to this world, in relation to nature, in relation to darkness, evil, all this stuff. We don't have any redemptive role whatsoever. And God, you're not in debt to God at all. This is what Jesus showed us. We are not in debt to God at all because, first of all, God didn't make bodies. God did not make this world. There is no battle between light and darkness. This is all dualistic delusion that spirit is projecting, that we're projecting. So he freed us from our sins, freed us from our debts, paid our debt to God, so to speak. Jesus paid our debt to God, but what he really did was inform us we don't have any debt with God. We don't have any debt. We are not creatures that God created for some work to save God from darkness, to save God from evil, to save, you know. We are not that at all. So Jesus did not oppose those who came with evil intentions to crucify him. Did not oppose it at all. Showing us this is all a dream that we're engaged in. Now the sins that we think we have are the sins of not being able to accomplish this work as well as God wants us to accomplish it. The idea of redeeming light from the darkness, freeing up the world from the contamination of Satan and the darkness and all this stuff. We think that's our holy mission that God created us for. And we're not doing a good enough job, so we think we're falling short, we're sinning, missing the mark. Jesus said, you don't have any such mission from God. Therefore, you're not sinning at all. God did not create you as some creature to redeem anything at all. You're created as your spirit. You're totally free. God created you as an extension of God, perfect and free. You're not bound at all to any such mission. So this is the radical teaching of Jesus. And in those Manichaean times, and Zoroastrian times, and Abrahamic religious times, the traditions, the ancient traditions, which those are three, along with all the pagan traditions, the mystery cults, all the pagan traditions, and then the Abrahamic teachings of Judaism, along with Manichaeism and Zoroastrianism, these fundamentally form this nexus of belief. Certainly in much of the civilized world, in the Indus Valley, you had the Vedic culture of India, which was being influenced, heavily influenced by Buddhism, actually. At the time of Christ, certainly. But in the Western tradition, we certainly had this belief that we had this terrible debt to pay off. You know, it's kind of like when you're put in when you feel you have a debt, you feel horrible, terrible. You feel so oppressed. And you feel you need to work it off somehow, and you feel you'll never be able to pay it off. This is how we feel in this world. We feel that somehow God put us here, and that we must be like debtors, like a debtor prison. Somehow we owe God something for life. You know, God gave us life, and now we have to pay that gift back through somehow defeating evil, that sort of thing. Jesus told us this is all nonsense. None of it is true. So he freed us from this belief in sin, freed us from the belief that we owe God, we're indebted. And freed us from the belief that we have to do anything at all with nature. See, the thing about the ancient religions is that they taught, not including Buddhism, okay, but the other religions of the time, for the most part, taught that we're supposed to be here in nature because we have work to do with nature, the redemptive work. And so this is where we have to be. We have to be involved with nature. We have to. And Jesus said, no, it's not true. You don't have to be involved with nature at all. Come to supernature. Come to my dwelling place. He said, this is not my kingdom at all. I have nothing to do with this place. He invited us to supernature, his true home, his dwelling place, kingdom of heaven. So he's saying, no, you don't have any, you're not bound to this world. You're not bound to nature at all. You don't have any obligation to nature whatsoever. None. This was just, totally radical teaching for the times, and still is, because the world is very dualistic still. Most of the teachings are just extrapolations, continuations of Zoroastrianism and Manichaeism, and various teachings about thinking that there's something, we have some redemptive work that needs to take place. We need to free the soul from its contaminations, free the soul from darkness. Gnosticism is another dualistic teaching that was very popular, has been. And all that stuff is, and along with paganism, it's all, which is nature worship, really. It's all still super intense in this world. All this false teaching. And Jesus brought a radical New Testament. A New Testament. He says, don't put this new wine into old wineskins. Doesn't work. He brought a New Testament. Very new. Very different. Very different. And so what we're doing here is we're pointing out the difference of it. We're under no obligation to nature whatsoever. Absolutely none. In fact, we made nature as a prison for our spirit, to try to imprison our spirit, to try actually to change what we are. And what Jesus essentially told us is you can't change what you are. So, nature's useless to you, actually. It's totally useless. But you have a continuity problem, so let's take the intermediate step of supernature. We're not under any obligation to stay in prison. This is supposed imprisonment. We're not under any obligation to try and change what we are. The notion that God wants us to try and change what we are is lunacy. Okay. The notion that anything that God created, which is everything, nothing unreal exists. What is real cannot be threatened, and what is unreal doesn't exist. We don't have to continue to try and change ourselves. And nature cannot change reality. Reality is not under any threat of change. There is no evil force that's able to change reality. There's nothing. Reality doesn't have to be protected. It doesn't have to be redeemed at all. It's never been imprisoned whatsoever. Spirit tried to imprison itself and change itself, and it's impossible to do this. And this is what Jesus is telling us. The resurrection showed us you really can't do it at all. You cannot change what you are. Putting bodies through cycles of death, cycles of nature, doesn't touch the spirit at all. We keep thinking that all this impermanence, all this constant change, death, this is how we're imagining the machinery of change, of being able to change what we are. We cannot change what we are in the slightest bit. I also speculated, I wondered if I wasn't in a scene back at the time of Jesus, and may have heard of Jesus, or maybe seen him at some point. Maybe I was someone there, and feeding the multitudes or something, or maybe I heard a sermon from him or something back at that time. It's very possible. I seem to have an Essene mentality. I feel like I cannot deal with. They didn't have any money. They didn't work for profit. I feel unable to work for money or profit. I cannot relate to money and getting it at all. And it's much of the Essene ideology. I feel like this is my ideology somehow. So it's probable that I was had a lifetime there in Judea or somewhere in that region, and may have seen Jesus, probably, you know, at a distance, just maybe listening and just saying, "Wow, what is this? This is very interesting," and got infused into me, and I've carried that with me throughout many successive incarnations. And it's sort of, you know, growing like a seed. The seed got into me. It's growing. And I tried to avoid it, you know, I don't know what to do about it. And then finally this life, I'm trying to finally come to grips with this. Is what is this new teaching? What is this New Testament? So there were many, many, many that saw Jesus, actually. And you know, just while him walking by, or you see him at a distance, Gary's extremely profound. The seed is there, you know, the seed. And maybe those 2,000 years ago that saw him then are waking up now at the end of this age. That is quite possible, actually, because again, I feel, many feel that Jesus wasn't a seed. That was the religion of his parents, so to speak, was and his relatives was a saint. We're not sure about that. I'm not sure if scholars really know exactly what was his religious background. Was he a Pharisee, a Sadducee, or an Essene, or a zealot, or what was his background? And many feel that his teachings are very much similar to the Essenes. And my basics, you know, sort of religious sense is sort of like an Essene. I abhor many things. I just, it's coming more and more powerfully, this whole, and I feel like I'm liking a scene. So, you know, maybe there was some connection with Jesus in some way, somehow. I don't feel it was like some central connection or anything like that. But there may have been some connection at that time. And now, so the seed has grown, and now it's, plant is giving fruit now, finally, at the end of this age. quite possible. Because it's hard to explain how else would anybody, you know, be so dedicated to trying to unravel the mystery of Jesus and all that. And, you know, it just seems like extremely important to understand what is the teaching really? What is the salvational teaching really? And, I must feel like there's something there really important, and some reason for it, various reasons for it. I was one of those who early on was involved with A Course in Miracles, and I felt like I was a test pilot for it. It was like extremely important, and I knew ahead of time it was coming into the world, okay? I was aware, and I told people, I said, there's going to be a book coming into the world that is going to be absolutely incredible, and it's going to answer your questions, religious questions that you have. So I was definitely aware of that. So I must have been in the loop of what Jesus was doing somehow. And then I felt I was like a test pilot for A Course in Miracles. I needed to put all my life's effort into this. And I was tutored, met with Jesus quite a few times during sleep, when I was doing this, and just recently met with Jesus in sleep, and I was invited to visit his dwelling place. So there's some connection there, and it probably is ancient. It was probably during his first coming. I must have had some connection. I don't see, you know, that certainly makes sense. I've never thought of it until this just now. I never even thought of that, but would certainly fit. I did have a dream years ago, maybe a decade ago or so, where I attended this party. I was invited and came to this party, and I was brought around to everyone at the party, and every single one there greeted me with tremendous happiness and welcomed me. You know, welcome, welcome, welcome. And I realized these were all the apostles of Jesus. And they were all gathering together, waiting for him to come, arrive. And he was soon to arrive. And they all accepted me as an equal companion, their companion. So, where did they come from? These were all very people who'd known Jesus, I felt, for a long time. So, yeah, it's like that in the world. In some degree, I don't know what, how much. But I certainly didn't understand his teachings then, if that's the case. Did not understand his teachings, no. I only would have known that, hey, there's something different here. There's something better here. This, you know, there is real, this is worthy of attention here. What's going on here? So it got my attention. You know, Jesus was an attention getter. Big time attention getter. And then I said, wait a minute. And then trying to get free of this dualistic, you know, teachings of this world is very difficult. It may have taken me many lifetimes, actually, just to get to this point here. Not only many, many lifetimes, but this lifetime of complete dedication to it. So the dualistic teachings really have a grip on us, because our continuity fear is so severe that we feel that we need these teachings. They justify our fear, you know. And without them, we think that we'd be thrown into some dreadful annihilation or something. So it is quite possible I have a long association with Jesus and his teachings. It's quite possible. I mean, to be able to feel so comfortable with it now, this, you know, it just doesn't happen by accident. Again, I'm not claiming the slightest specialness whatsoever, you know. For all I know, I was some peasant in Galilee or somewhere, just or who knows, I may have been part of the Roman Empire at that time, you know. Working in some bureaucratic function, or I could have been a Sadducee or a Pharisee or a zealot, or so, you know, I could have. Could have been a Gentile, could have been a Jew. Probably had incarnations as a Jew for sure in the past. The capacity of tremendous study and focus and attention, something that the Jews tend to, their culture puts a great premium on that. And so I have a lot of these traits. When I was young, almost all my friends were Jewish, actually. I tended to gravitate to them, or they gravitated to me. And we seem to have a similar intensity, you know, so it's very possible I was Jewish back in the day of Jesus. But I certainly wouldn't have understood his teaching. No. Maybe just the tiniest glimmer, you know, tiniest glimmer. Oh, I know what he's talking about, but that's a tiny, tiny, tiny little glimmer, you know. And I know it's something that people say, that they say, oh yeah, I was with Jesus back then. I was, you know, so and so, real close. You know, like his closest apostle. You know, or I was Mary Magdalene. I was this or that. You know, yeah. No, I was just probably a knucklehead, Jewish knucklehead at the time. Probably really into, you know, studying the Tanakh or the Torah. And who is this guy? Yeah. I may be in persecuted. I don't know. Who is this guy? I says, what is this? You know, probably was very arrogantly, you know, dismissive. But at the same time, maybe I took a peek and said, well, what is this rabbi? What is he talking about here? You know, I wanna try to understand what's he getting at here. So maybe I had some intellectual curiosity, you see, and just said, huh. Yeah, I'm gonna keep this in mind. I must have given him a hearing or something, you know, just a little hearing, because that's all he tells us. Just give me a little hearing, you know, instead of don't shut me out completely. It's like a court case. Hear from both sides. Let him speak for himself in his defense. Well, what is he talking about, really? And you know, it's probably like all the, you know, people of that time, you know, most people, you know, rejected him. And those who maybe accepted him thought, hey, here's someone who fits right into our beliefs. And I thought he was going to do this and didn't. So really, he said nobody really understood what he was saying. And said Peter kind of got it. He got it better than the others, supposedly. But he said, no, none of them get it. None of you get it, really. But you will eventually. Real eventually. They really didn't understand what he was talking about. So really, nobody did. Nobody understood. And, you know, it's understandable. But you come in teaching pure non-dualism, absolutely pure. Holy cow. Of course, there is only one kind of non-dualism, and that's pure non-dualism. And the people, dualists are not going to understand that at all. But something inside us understands it. Something inside it gets it. So the honesty is to say, wait a minute, I feel like an attraction to this. It's like I understand it, but I really don't. I think he's crazy, you know. But I also feel I understand it. This is weird. So there's probably some conflict starts at that time. Say, this is really weird. How come I feel like I agree and understand what he's saying, and yet my mind is telling me I don't understand anything he's saying? He's a complete lunatic. You know, this is very strange. So it sets up this puzzle, you know, and you try to solve this puzzle. It may take many, 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 many lifetimes. From that start, like, wait a minute, this is some strange conflict. What's going on here? And so it may be that the fruits of this time, the tree was planted back at his first coming. Absolutely. Highly likely, actually. Highly likely. Now, it is true that all non-duality is pure non-duality. And Buddhism is also pure non-duality, actually. And some say that Jesus went to India to study Buddhism, or Hinduism, Upanishads, or whatever, studied under these spiritual teachers in India. Well, it may be that he went to India somewhere. I'm not sure, to study under them, possible, or maybe they studied under him, you see. I'm not sure, but there's no like lineage saying that he started some lineage in India and necessarily like that. But there's much talk that he was in India, actually, which is not surprising, because pure non-duality is the only non-duality there is. Buddhism is pure non-duality. So are the teachings of Jesus, pure non-duality, purely non-dual, non-dual teachings. So I don't, you know, even so, I'm definitely. I have affinity for Jesus' presentation of non-duality, but I certainly understand Buddhist teachings also about non-duality. It's, you know, it's just a different style kind of thing. Then there's also, you know, other teachings, other styles too. But I don't feel like I'm predominantly a Buddhist. I don't feel that way. I certainly can relate to it all in its basic, in its purity, and absolutely. But I don't see myself as in that tradition, in that lineage tradition. It's possible I might have in ancient times been in India, in the Upanishad, Vedic culture. I mean, we've had many lives on this planet. You could have been, you know, in the Stone Age in some culture, in the Bronze Age. There was a lot of people in the world moving around, you know, and a lot of bodies. And it's always possible I got some teaching in the, you know, Hindu, or relate to the Hindu teachings, but not, you know, not essentially. I feel somehow the spark of Jesus, you know, really somehow got into me, and I said I want to really resolve this puzzle here, where I say I understand but I don't understand. What is this? And it's a challenge to the intellect, isn't it? It's like, wow, the intellect says, wow, how's that possible that I'm simultaneously feeling I understand and I don't understand? So this is incredible. Wasn't I going crazy? Yeah. Fact is, we do understand, because we're spirit, you see. And the saying I don't understand is the belief that the effort to change spirit says, I don't understand how spirit could possibly not could possibly be unchanged by all this nature mechanism of change that we're subjecting spirit to. We think we're subjecting spirit to. We're not subjecting spirit to any mechanism of change whatsoever, but we think we are. So we're saying it's impossible that spirit cannot be changed now. So spirit can't be what it is. So it can't possibly, it can't know these teachings of Jesus, which says spirit is unchanged. It can't know these teachings. No, it's not possible. And yet there's something within us that does know it. So we say, wow, I know it, but there's no way I can know it. So it creates this incredible conflict, you know. And then we think, well, I'll get rid of it by dying. But it didn't die with the best of the body. This conflict didn't die. So another life and another life, and keep thinking, you know, how can I get free of this conflict within me, you know? Each time you think, okay, that's it. You know, this I've done enough, and this death will free me. Doesn't free me. I remember this. And so now this life, I realize, wow. Okay, now I'm finally sort of getting it and seeing what's going on. We haven't changed, we have not changed what we are. Not in the slightest bit. That's why we know these teachings. Oh, I know that. I always wonder, like, how can I say I know that? I remember growing up and there were these teachers and spiritual people that I'd listen to, and I would always say, yeah, I know that. Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. I understand that. And they said, what are you talking about? You're just a kid. You know, you can't know this stuff. It's taken me a lifetime to know, to work on this. I still don't get it. And you're saying, I know it. I say, yeah, I know this. This is spirit speaking. And see, I hadn't, all the habits of attention hadn't, you know, like really got a hold of me so bad when I was young. So I said, of course, it's self-evident. I understand this. I know this is true. I know this is true. Yeah, they said something wasn't true. I said, no, that's not true. I know it's not true. Just simply, just like that, without any other explanation. I just know. They said, how do you know this? What do you mean, how do I know it? Knowing, how do you know it's self-evident? What kind of question is that? They said, well, how can't be self-evident because you're just a kid, you know? You know, stupidity on their part, of course. Severe continuity fear. So, and then they say, no, you have to learn this. You got to be taught this. We'll teach you, you know. And that's then the beginning of idiocy. And then you get this dichotomy of, I know, but I don't know. How come I know? And they start thinking, well, you know, what? How come I know? What is that? Who's the knower? How come I know? How is this possible that I know, and then I think I don't know? The world says, I don't know, I shouldn't be able to know this. Creates all this confusion in us. Well, we know because we're still spirit. We're still what we are. And we don't know because we think it's not possible that we're still what we are. So we can't possibly know. It's kind of like a logical fallacy saying, we all this effort must have succeeded to change what we are, so we can't possibly know what we are. It's not possible. It's a logical fallacy. Because the fallacy is to say that all this effort to change what we are has to have worked. Simply why? Because there's no way it couldn't work? Well, where's the proof of that? That's an a priori premise that spirit can be changed, right? It's just a matter of time and effort, but it can be changed. So where do we get this premise that it, you know, we made it up? There's no premise in reality that spirit can be changed. So it's a made-up premise that we're using, and then reasoning from that made-up premise, and saying, yeah, it has, all this nature's been going on for billions of years. It must have changed what we are. You know, no question, had to. We have to be somewhat determinate. We're determinate for sure. And we say, no, I'm completely indeterminate. We say, no, it's not possible. Not possible. What do you mean, not possible? What is not possible is to change what we are, is to make ourselves determinate. That's what's not possible. So people would not accept that from a young person. They would not accept it. They don't even accept it from an older person. But of course they don't deny reincarnation. They say, you can't possibly, what are you talking about? You're a child of nature. Nature is intrinsically changed. We're human beings. We're not spirit anymore. We're human beings. Oh, sure, we have a soul or a spirit or something, but essentially we're human beings, they tell us. And in other words, we've been able to change spirit into flesh. in the indeterminate into determinatism, into that which is determinate. So when you ask, well, what's Jesus going to say? What's this teaching? Well, he's going to tell you about this. I'm just, you know, tipping you off, sharing. We have a false premise. We have a false premise that somehow is possible for us to be determinate. It is not possible for reality to be determinate. We're completely free. And so off of this false premise, we built this whole scenario of saying, well, this must have worked. And then believing that we must be the body. The body must be a part of spirit, the determinate part of spirit. I mean, many dualists say that, yeah, we're both body and spirit, meaning we're both determinate and indeterminate. That's not true. It's not true. In fact, Jesus says essentially right now, say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. And I say, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. We're not determinate at all. Not in the slightest bit. So those who say, yeah, that the body and the spirit are one and partly determinate, partly indeterminate, and the synthesis of this, the integration of the determinate and indeterminate, it's all nonsense. That's Manichaean, Zoroastrian, Gnostic duality. It's not the teachings of Jesus at all. But how to recognize this is very difficult, I found, because the continuity fear, exchanging belief systems is, you know, every time you change one, it feels the structure shifts and changes, and you say, wow, I don't quite understand it any longer. And you know, it's just brutally difficult, actually. But you certainly can make it easier on yourself, which is the whole point of helping and encouraging others, is to make it easier. But it's exchanging belief systems is never going to be a simple, problem-free situation, especially with this extremely rapid continuity fear we have. Yeah, we're going to just take a little bit from one and put it the other. And as Jesus says, the path is all about willingness to give a little to the Holy Spirit, your attention just a little bit, and what you take away from duality, you're giving to non-duality. And it's just gradually transferring more and more of your attention, more and more of your attention, gradual transfer. I felt like it was like defusing some nuclear bomb or something. It was just like, if I do the slightest thing wrong, kaboom. And so I was like, you know, shaking and fear, trembling. A lot of time I was at severe anxiety. Because of dualistic teachings, it's so crazy. You think that you're supposed to redeem, you know, what you're doing is like, it's essential, that there's something that we have to do. There's nothing we have to do. There's no danger whatsoever. You know, eventually you start realizing this, and then anxiety gets less. It can pick up again when you're very close to finishing, because then the whole thing says, oh, wait a minute, maybe this last part is the fuse, kaboom, you know. So it can be some trepidation towards the end, for sure. But it's more manageable, because you're onto the situation. All light's going to be released from darkness. No, there's no release at all. As Longchamp says, release, released, as it were, released in the, you know, and he has some great ways of putting it. Lack of anything to release. There isn't anything, nothing is trapped. Everything is completely saturated with pure spaciousness, intrinsically and always. Nothing is entrapped whatsoever. Entrapped in what? Lack of pure spaciousness? There's no lack at all. Because everything's equally saturated. At all. There's no gap. There's no gap. It's completely seamless. There's no darkness that creates a gap in pure spaciousness. Spaciousness is totally oblivious, so to speak, of specific appearances. Zero dimensional, total absence. It doesn't differentiate or judge between appearances. Is this brighter or is this less bright? In terms of what? There's no differentiation there at all. There's no judgment of qualities. It's totally free of all qualities. And the need to judge them, it is simply the presence that saturates all appearance. Wherever appearance appears to be, that saturation of pure spaciousness is there. So, again, it is possible that I had some lives as a Buddhist or Hindu too. Also, it's very possible because that's a very ancient culture, for sure. And some say that everyone's had at least one incarnation in India. That's possible because at any given time in history, like, there's a large percentage of the population of the world happen to be in India. That's very true. Very populous. Even right now, like what about a seventh of the world is in India? It's got over what is it, a billion people or more than a billion people in India now. So I certainly understand like what Longjempa is his expressions. I certainly understand it, but I don't quite, you know, resonate with the terminology. Don't have really great familiarity with it. And of course, lifetimes as a pagan, as we all have, a familiarity with paganism, of course. The dance, the song, the drama, the festival, the battle, it's the competition, the strife, the struggle, the riches, you know, everything about paganism, you know, we've all had lives like that. We say, maybe we just don't think about all this, it'll just go away. Let's just drown it in food and drink. Just in festivals, let's just make it all go away. Forget it, don't think about it. That doesn't work either. So yeah, there's paganism, which is just is trying to get on the good side of nature. And then we have these religious expressions of maybe monotheistic religions that teach it as dualistic monotheism that says, oh, you know, no, it's just if you align with God, God will help you, give you the power to crush the bad stuff of nature, and it's dualistic. And then you have non-dual teachings, so we kind of go from paganism to duality to non-duality. Paganism has lots of deities. Everywhere they go, every nature spirit. How could I deal with this nature spirit? What kind of deal I need to make? Get them to help me out, or not to punish me. And so they worship. They have, do sacrifice and say, here, take this. I'll give you something. You want to hurt me, but take this instead. And animal sacrifice and all this stuff. That's pagan worship, trying to work with nature, get nature to be nice to them. Of course, what they don't realize is nature is just our own projection, trying to change what we are, intrinsically change what we are. That's why sometimes, pagans convert, like St. Augustine converted from paganism to Christianity. And he said, hey, the pagans think that everything, nature or something, is happening to them, like an oppressive force, like an evil force outside of them, and that this misfortune is brought upon them by, and they need to pray to what, you know, whatever inflicted this punishment or misfortune on them. They need to find out and offer tithes and sacrifice. He said, no. We bring all this misfortune on ourselves. It comes from us. This is St. Augustine. Okay. Great realization. Great Christian. But he was a pagan, absolutely. In fact, I believe he was a Manichaean, absolutely. Manichaean, he was. He believed in this duality, and he converted and said, no, this is not true, this is not true. We are not being attacked by evil forces and all this duality. It is our own, we are the authors of our own misfortune and sin and misery, actually. That's a very profound conversion, for sure. And we're all still called to this, and we all still struggle with this, that is for sure. We keep thinking there's some evil force out there as dualism. Again, nature is our attempt to change what we are. It's not God's attempt to change what we are. It's our attempt to change what we are. And so, of course, we inflict all this in the crucible. We throw ourselves in the crucible of change here. And we inflict all sorts of torment upon the body, circumstances, situations. But we're the one who are dreaming up all these circumstances. And we may be hit by stuff to come. It's inevitable, isn't it, in this dream of trying to change what we are. We are really in the crucible, and the crucible is put in the fire, and the fire is heated up, and it's going to, you know, when we go from copper, you know, tin, copper, and the combined bronze, and then iron ore combined with carbon to get steel, you need higher heat. You need higher heat, so there's like long time, like a couple thousand years of the Bronze Age, right? It was maybe a couple thousand years before entered into the Iron Age, where, because the heat required, they had to build special smelting ovens that was able to get enough heat so the iron would absorb the charcoal, iron ore would absorb the charcoal, come out with steel. It was difficult. But so greater heat, we put ourselves in the crucible of greater pressure and heat to try to change what we are. And so, is it reasonable to expect this will continue? Of course. You have a world full of people, of spirits, companions, our companions in spirit. We're all one family, all companions to one another. And they're just still stuck in a lot of continuity fear. They believe that there's all these forces of nature that can cause catastrophes and bring sorts of problems and on bodies. But again, this is all actually worked out at a deep level by spirit, telling mind, okay, to do this. And we're actually causing this all to happen. We're dreaming all these catastrophes. We're dreaming all these issues. Spirit is, not the human body. Human body is just the punching bag for all this. It's the symbol of spirit and the symbol of the capacity, the idea of being able to change what spirit is. Ultimately, you see, you'd be able to change what spirit is. Something determinate here that can be a form, that can be pummeled by so much stuff, right? I mean, just look at history and the unbelievable pummeling of bodies throughout history. In so many, 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 many different ways. So many plagues, droughts, famines, wars, pestilence, all your crops get eaten up by locusts, you know, and you starve to death, and just, you know, illnesses of every variety, misfortunes of every variety. The history of the Jews, you know, sold into slavery, the ten tribes of Israel sold into slavery, the Syrians scattered, a lot of them, and then later on, the Romans came in and wiped out Jerusalem and Judea, and sold all the Jews into, most of the Jews into slavery. Okay, slavery. You die rowing, you know, in boats, and die in battle, and some galley slave in a boat. You eat some bad food, you catch some illness, you get a sickness, you know, you get an infection, you get an infected tooth, you die. I mean, it's like virtually almost infinite. This body is like some custom designed punching bag, actually, for nature, to inflict all sorts of misery and suffering upon it, so that we can play this game of believing like, hey, we're changing what we are. We're changing what we are here. We're wearing away the resistance of spirit, death after death after death, suffering after suffering. We're wearing away what we are, gradually transforming it like alchemy, the alchemy of nature. Yeah. Well, the good news, Jesus told us, there is no alchemy. There's none whatsoever. We cannot change what we are in the slightest regard. There's no transformation. There's no alchemy. There's no redemption. There's no nothing. Nothing has to happen for us to be what we are. We don't have to remove any stains whatsoever. We are not stained. We are not defiled. Our purity is still perfect. I glimpsed my true self a few days ago, and I saw the perfection. I was absolutely pure. There's not the slightest stain there whatsoever. And it's not because I removed anything. It's because it's always been that way. Dualism will say, oh yeah, it's we're all defiled. We have to get rid of that defilement. And that's what the human body is here for. It's, you know, it's nonsense. Since we're trying to change what we are, we use the body as a punching bag. We'll keep, you know, the people who believe that this is what they need to do, because the continuity fear tells them that it's too late. The spirit's already been totally changed. You know, you just have to finish it, finish the process, because inside they still have this knowing. Say, well, we haven't quite finished it yet. We've got to really amp up the heat here, you know, and make it hotter, the crucible hotter, melt down the last remaining aspect of spirit. Well, it's likely there's going to be some heat brought to bear upon us, and you know, it's very possible. Jesus tells us that that's what's going to happen now. So we shall see, but it doesn't matter, because nature doesn't touch us. Nature can do nothing to us, nothing whatsoever, absolutely nothing whatsoever. The whole universe can melt down into some super hot flame of infinite temperature. It doesn't touch spirit in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. High energy, the whole universe can go into some super high energy state. It doesn't affect spirit whatsoever. Untouched. Untouched. We're completely untouched. So don't worry about any catastrophe or this or this or that, because it doesn't touch what we are in the slightest bit. It can even not even touch the body if we want it not to. We just, you know, because we don't have to use the body as a punching bag. We're just insisting upon it. It doesn't have to be a punching bag. It doesn't have to be vulnerable. It's just an appearance. How can an appearance be vulnerable? We're just desiring this appearance moment by moment. We can just continue to desire the appearance any way we want to, any moment. We just think that nature is determinate. It's not. It's our creativity imagining it as if it were determinate. But it's still completely dependent on our creativity, moment by moment creativity, our spontaneous moment by moment creativity, completely rests on that foundation, completely dependent. It is completely indeterminate. Every moment is totally free and clear of it. Every other moment is totally indeterminate. Yeah, that's right. This body, this universe, this world, this nature, everything is totally indeterminate. It is not a creation of God. God is not a creator like that. God is into the freedom of experiencing, of infinite expressions of experiencing, and the freedom to do this, you see, over and over, whatever we want. The perfect freedom of absolutely endless, infinite, glorious expressions of experiencing in our freedom. is not, God is not some creator structuring a universe, structuring planets, structuring nature. That is not God, that is us, spirit, trying to change what we are, actually. And it's all actually unstructured. There is no structure of the universe. It's simply we are imagining it as if it were structured, as if it were structured. But again, it's totally dependent, moment by moment, on actually a collective play this is among many aspects of spirit, among the oneness. In this oneness, this is an expression of many aspects of spirit are intrigued by. And it seems like a very wild, wild experience, adventure. But it's still totally indeterminate, totally indeterminate. And Jesus pointed this out many times by multiplying the loaves of bread and the fishes, feeding the multitudes. Maybe I was there, I don't know. And it's like the people who were there just said, hey, wait a minute. Well, what is this? How could he be doing this? That's ridiculous. Just five loaves of bread and fish, and he's feeding thousands of people here. It's like, wow, what's going on here? Bells go off and say, wait a minute. I feel like I know what's happening, but how could I know? That's crazy. I'm just a stupid human idiot here. How could I know anything like this? But yet I still feel like something I can know. And no, I can't know this. It's a conflict. Well, how did he do it? He knew it's all indeterminate. It's just inherently, completely indeterminate. So you want more fish, you got more fish. You want more bread, you have more bread. Just because he said, oh, there's a lot of hungry people here, okay. Let's feed them. That's all. So appearance of bread, appearance of fish, there you go. He did not believe in determinism whatsoever. So it's effortless. It's just that we're believing in this is all determinate, so we can't do that. No, it's impossible. Same thing with raising the dead. Death's completely indeterminate. Do we think that death is a determinate ending of life, so to speak, of this body? And there's no question it is determinate, okay? So it's sort of like the cornerstone of we no longer can move. We can't change, our condition at all. We're just inert now. and then we dissolve away, even that dissolves away. And so he said it's very determinate, no question about it. Jesus said, no, even death is totally indeterminate. Totally indeterminate. He said, kill this body, I'll raise it up again. No problem. Just an appearance. So we may have been all emotional about this, seeing this and saying, wow, miracle, incredible. But some part of us is saying, I know this, I can do this too. See, I can do this too. And Jesus said, greater miracles than this ye shall do. Well, of course, because reality is totally indeterminate. It all is totally indeterminate. There's nothing we cannot do except change what we are. We can have, a trillion fish if we want. A trillion loaves of bread. Like that is it all is indeterminate. We are the extension of the prime creator. Okay, we are, spirit is the extension of the prime creator. It's not the prime creator without being extended. It is the extension of the prime creator. Spirit is the extension of the prime creator. It's the prime creator extending itself. And spirit is that extension of prime creator. Not separate from prime creator, it's an extension of prime creator. So spirit has all creative capacity. Whatever it imagines, whatever it wants to experience, instantly it is so. Instantly it is so. There's nothing to prevent it from being so. There's no determinism whatsoever to prevent it from being so. again, there's part of us just saying, yeah, I understand this, of course, it's obvious. And there's another part of saying, wow. Wow. Is it possible that I haven't changed really, haven't changed at all? Is that possible? This is astonishing. This is how of a story of this is how we changed what we are, you see. It's a huge backstory. Now we're saying here, none of that was necessary. It's all a waste of time. Idly wandering about, idle wish, nothing ever happened. It's like, holy cow, that's really, amazing. Amazing, nothing ever happened, nothing ever has happened. Nothing has ever changed. And that's a wow, that's a very profound wow. It hits us hard for sure. And certainly, we struggle with it. What I'm suggesting is there's a way to struggle with it that helps you, makes it easier for you. And there's a way that makes it more difficult. And having been through it, I know that wow, it can get really tough. And if you don't, you have to gradually get smooth it out how you deal with the situation. Otherwise, it's going to tear you apart. You say, I know this is true, I know it, but how can I know it? It's not, where's the story of how did I get to know it? There's no story of how we got to know what we are, already have always been. There isn't any such story. So you don't need to say, well, how did I redeem light from darkness? That has nothing to do with what I am. No, of knowing what that I don't need to do such a redemption. It's like, well, how did I manage to redeem myself so that I know I didn't need to redeem myself? Whoa, wait a minute. Like, wait a second here. Stop right there. There's something wrong with this formulation. Something wrong with that equation. That I needed to redeem light from darkness in order to realize that I don't need to redeem light from darkness. That doesn't happen. I mean, I needed to do something to know that I already know that I don't need to do anything to know what I am. This is what we're struggling with deep down. Wait a minute. You say, wait just a minute here. It's like, I know this is true, that I already am what I am, and I don't need to do anything. But how did I know that, get to know that? No, I've already always known it. There's no how did we get to be what we are. How did we? There is none of that. Said, well, how did I earn the right to know that I've always known? Wait. If I've already always known, why do I need a right to know? How can I have earned that right to know if I've always known? You see, he says, wait a minute. I say, so, the spirit has this, like, confusion, sort of. If you relax into non-dual vidence, you're aware that Your companions in spirit are still like saying, like, wait a minute, but I need there's something that has to happen, I need to do something. But they're very confused as to what it is, and so you get confused too, and then you're confused. And it's this circular thinking, it's this circular confusion of, well, how okay, so I'm already here, and there's nothing I need to do, and I know everything is self-evident, but how did I free myself so that I can know this? Didn't do anything. You're already free. You've always been free. You didn't free yourself. So it's really, the real thing is, how did I manage not to change what I am? They want that answer. How is it that I was able to not change what I am? There's no answer to that. How can you answer that? You can't change what you are. There's no how. There's no how to it. It's like saying, how did I not do? How did I manage to not do the impossible? How can you answer that? How did I manage to not do the impossible? You could say, I want to make sure that I keep on managing it that way. You don't need to manage to not do the impossible. You don't need to have a know-how as to how to not do the impossible. So everyone's looking at this story saying, okay, where did I get the know-how? Where did the know-how come in? I need know-how to make sure that I don't accomplish the impossible. And there's really nothing to do about this except to laugh at it, you know? What other resolution can there be except to have a good laugh about it, right? It's an absurdity. Is there some sane response to an absurdity? There isn't, is there? I mean, the sane response is to laugh. I say, oh yeah, okay, it's impossible. I can't change what I am. But how did I manage to do that? How did I manage to realize it's impossible? Because we haven't changed at all. We've never changed. So how could... Now, the question is of realizing this, accepting it, is we work on the continuity problem, which we're aware of. Okay. The confusion goes deeper than that, though. So ultimately, the answer is you simply just have to laugh at the absurdity. Jesus tells us the real problem is we forgot to laugh at the absurdity of it. Even Longchamp says that there's nothing to do except to burst out laughing, really, is absurdity. So make sure to keep your sense of humor, because at the root of it, there's just a laugh at a way. How ridiculous is that? It's just ridiculous. You laugh at what's ridiculous, you laugh at it. No, there's no structured answer at all. How did I manage to not do the impossible? How can you answer that? You don't say, I'm here as spirit, unchangeable spirit, because I finally managed to not do the impossible. That's why I'm here. See, that's the fallacy of non-attainment. Okay, both attainment and non-attainment are equal to delusions, duality of attainment and non-attainment. We're not here but through non-attainment. We're not what we are through non-attainment. Say, you know what, I managed to not change what I am. That implicitly implies that it is possible to change who we are, but we managed to not do the impossible, meaning it must be possible to do the impossible. See how duality at its root is this very ridiculousness. But people, you can't laugh at that. You can't laugh, gotta answer it. Gotta answer it. No answer. So saying we have to answer what can't be answered is a trap, isn't it? It's a trap. That's why it's very important to practice no answer. No answer. Get used to that. Hearing non-dual, absolute talk. And feel it. I'm not getting the answers I need. What is that? It means you're not getting the answers. How did you manage to not do the impossible? You're not getting that answer. That's right. You're not getting that answer. We're not getting it, not getting it, not getting it. And we get frustrated. Say, Jesus, I just need an answer. Just answer me that. How did I manage to not do the impossible? Then I'll be free. And of course, trying to address that, you automatically believe that it is possible to do the impossible. Because you're saying you managed to not do it. So there's some necessity to manage to not do it. So that must mean it is possible to do the impossible. That must be your belief. It's a trap. So we get upset. How come, Jesus, you're not answering this? How come you're not answering it? God, you never answer my question. And we get angry like that. And God says, there is no answer. How did I manage to not do the impossible? We say, it's incredible. I managed to not do the impossible. How incredible is that? I must be, it's amazing. I want to know about this. Tell me, God, how did I manage that? This is why often the saints are depicted as laughing, the laughing Buddha. You're laughing. It's absurd. You know, it's absurd. There's really nothing to do but to have a chuckle at it, really. And Jesus says that when we forget to laugh, that's when we have the problem. Because then we think, I gotta figure this out. How did I manage it after? And then you're lost to non-dual abidance. You're lost to it at that point, right away. And so the people come to you, people come to teachers, for instance, and they say, God won't answer this question for you. I know you can't. You're a teacher. You're enlightened, so you can give me the answer. Just tell me. I gotta know the answer. And okay, and trying to figure out, you know, how did I manage to not do the impossible? That's amazing. I managed to do that. And then you can't answer that. They say, oh, you're no teacher at all. You don't know how to, you're not good. You're no good. And then you can get trapped into saying, okay, I better try to answer it or try to explain it to them, or else they won't think I'm a teacher, you know. And then you get immediately, then you're trapped in duality just like that. Not trapped, but you're in another delusion of duality, that the impossible is possible. And you think, uh-oh, maybe I have changed my mind. Uh-oh, how do I manage not doing that? You know, not to do it. It's like that. Oh my gosh. Now, people ask, well, there are some people who feel very comfortable with Jesus. How is that possible? Well, he's not. Jesus' mission wasn't to make us strangers to him, make us some exotic, you know, strange. No, he said, I want y'all to be my companions. You realize we're all companions here. I don't want to be some distant, vague, you know, notion. Say, I want you to accept that you're my companion. I'm your companion. We're all one family of companions to one another in spirit. I don't want to be a stranger to you like that. No way. So of course, he's inviting us. Don't be a stranger to me. Come on, don't be a stranger. Don't be a stranger. Don't be a stranger. So it's not, shouldn't be a surprise that those who have worked at this very industriously feel like they're not a stranger to Jesus and not a stranger. Shouldn't be any surprise at all. And people shouldn't say, oh, in the world do you think you are? You think you're a companion of Jesus. You're crazy. You know, you must be deceived, you know, by darkness or something. No, that's the goal. The goal of Jesus' teaching is so that this barrier of strangeness is removed, is gone. Let go. He came here to remind us of the inherent companionship of the spirit. We're all spiritual companions to one another in reality. There's not higher or lower ruling over spirit. No, we're all perfectly free, indeterminate. He came to remind us of that fact. Which is why he just hung out with all sorts of people. He invited everyone to be companions with him. Says, you know, tax collectors even, right? Just all sorts of people. He said, you got no choice. We're all one. So just got to really start getting used to this fact. We're all one in spirit. We're all one in spirit. So we're hammering away here. Non-duality. And it still hasn't resolved, okay? But it's getting closer because we're really looking at the root of this with humor and not a problem. How did I manage to not do the impossible? Is this, you know, this other side of the coin, the attainment and non-attainment. And we're looking at the false idea of somehow light is trapped by darkness, and we have to redeem light from darkness, and that the human's job is a redemptive job to accomplish this. This is dualism. And, you know, that still has not completely resolved with me. I realize this, you know, but let it evaporate, see what happens tomorrow. Just hang in there and keep working. These are essential components of our trouble that we're literally airing out, letting them be evaporated. Essential components. So you know when you do that, it will bear fruit. How did I manage to not accomplish the impossible I want? I'm very intrigued. He goes, I'm very intrigued. How did you manage to do that? That's incredible. What a great accomplishment. How did you manage to have no attainment? What an incredible attainment that is. Yeah. Wait a minute. I said there's no attainment to be what I am, and now you're saying that non-attainment is a great attainment. Ah, see. Right there. Confusion. Keep your sense of humor. This is funny stuff. This is a smile. The inner smile is there. So I know the truth. Even when your body's suffering, my body feels terrible right now. Super tired and just nerves and you name it. You know, just wow, feels broken down. But it's okay. Because this is. The non-dual condition, the abidance and non-duality is it's already here. I just have to not get sucked into this confusion, this sort of circular delusion of circularity. And at that point, I imagine there'll be peace, the body will I'll allow the body to be better because it's all indeterminate anyway. So really break it down to a determinacy and indeterminacy if you want to get to the root of it. Because that dispenses with all appearances, appearance of light, appearance of darkness. Nothing is determinate whatsoever. So nothing has any form. Has, what was it? What's the teacher? Nagarjuna or something? The great non-dualist. Everything that's an Easter teaching, everything is completely empty, devoid of thing nature, so to speak. It's all indeterminate. This is a lot of teaching of Buddhism, is focusing on this. Emptiness, voidness. There is no determinant thing at all. I think maybe Shankara may have also taught that in Advaita, and others do. So there isn't any darkness, really. Okay, no, there isn't any light, really, as far as appearances go. It's all indeterminate. You can't say there's light because it's indeterminate. The next instant, you could have a darkness be there. Totally indeterminate. So the idea that there's a battle between light and dark is total delusion. because that means there's something to determinancy. The light is determined and the dark is determined. It is not true. It's mere appearance. All appearance is equally nothing. No thing. All appearance is equally indeterminate. All appearance is equally determined. There's no such thing as an appearance which is less indeterminate than some other appearance. There's no such thing as an appearance that's... Okay, that's the thing. So I need to say that I defeated determinacy. So I need this darkness to be determinate so the light can come in and make it indeterminate. No, there's no such situation at all in reality. There is no victory over determinacy whatsoever because determinacy has never existed. Never will exist. So. Good stuff. We're getting at it. So relax. Don't worry. Relax. Don't worry. We're getting it. We're getting to it. This is all that Longchenpa is saying. This is all that Jesus is saying. In a nutshell, it's just that simple. Bring it to the root. Indeterminacy. Stick with that. Gradually, you know, the clouds will part and evaporate. That's what I'm experiencing. It's like, wow, this is really cool. This is fun. This is a great way to spend some time. Can you imagine how much better you're doing this? You know how much better this is spending time this way than watching some television show, pants falling down comedy or something, you know? And you're just like, are you kidding? This is really cool. It's also rather funny. Funny to look at this absurdity. But seeing this absurdity directly like this is like, wow. Very profound. And it is this absurdity which has kept us going around in circles for so long. And now we're just seeing it very directly. Just laughing at it. So we're really evaporating the very core of our confusion right now. Now what happens when that's evaporated? I'm presuming, if the reason tells me, we abide in non-dual absoluteness. We simply abide in the non-dual absoluteness and make sure we don't get sucked into the confusion. Try to, remain in this abidance and not get sucked into this circular confusion. There are those who have done this, so they tell us, absolutely, you can do it. Absolutely. Some say the turnaround comes very suddenly, and that's it. Nisargadatta is one of those who said this. There are those who's from the sudden school. And, sudden turnaround, and poof, no more trouble. But whatever it is, certainly, we need to first, look at and see that, this is the absurdity. This is the confusion. It's just this absurdity. Because any attainment has to be the attainment of change of what we are, which has to be the belief that we're determinate, How can we have change? How can there be such a thing as change if there's no determinancy? What we call change. What is change? We're just freely choosing each moment. That's not change. That's life. But change would be meaning here's something that's determinate and you're altering it. There is no such change. No such thing as that change, actually. Yeah, nature appears to be that way. So, it's not a play of change, it's a play of desire and experiencing. That's not changing. Not in the way that the ego is looking at it. Wish me well, Leah. Just stay humble. Stay humble. Don't get caught up in the confusion. Try not to, but we can see it's an absurdity. So remember, it's an absurdity. There's no answer to it. All is indeterminate. There is no answer as to how we stop determinacy or manage to not become determinate. There is no such answer how we manage to not become determinate. No answer. It's an absurdity. Okay, very great. Progress is being made. Huge progress is being made. But we need to go swiftly, for sure, because we may try to bring about, heat the crucible up a little more in this world and try to keep changing what we are. And that's not really that fun, is it? All right, but we'll go quickly here. That's it.